I'd like to welcome everyone on this beautiful February morning. I am just so pleased to see the response we had for our Super Bowl Sunday. All the soup and crackers up there will be put to very good use. We'd like to thank each and every one of you who did this. Now, as the days get longer, we are glad to have a break in this winter weather. It is a beautiful day outside. Hopefully, we will recharge our spirits for the rest of the winter. It will be short from this time on, we hope. I'd like to start. We have a flower here in memory of for Eleanor Grace Deal, born Tuesday, February 28th, 8 pounds, 19 inches, parents of John and Catherine Deal. You're just. We are very glad that you are all here to worship with us this morning. There has been a lot of activities and celebrations, but we continue to have them. I would like to highlight a few. First of all, there is a Super Bowl watch party tonight at 5 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. You are all welcome to attend. American Baptist Women Coin Sunday will be next week, so be prepared for that. And also, the foundation dinner and silent auction is being held on February 29th of this year. Gary Smith tells me he is the expert on that, so if you have any questions about that, go see Gary Smith. And also, we have our Wednesday family night starting this week. We have a whole insert in our bulletin about Wednesday Family Night, and we hope you can attend. And I encourage you to put your activities that you are interested in your card, in your connection, in your Connect card. Please make sure you fill these out. These are important because we do review them as staff. We review any comments, anything that you like, anything you don't like, anything that you want us to do or you will be doing or sign up for. This is the place to do it. So please fill this out. They are pretty important. Please check your bulletins in the star for many of the events taking place. We are a very active church. And again, do not forget your cards. Very important. Now let us come before the Lord with joy, because he is faithful to his promises, because his word is eternal. Know that the Lord is God. We are his people, his community, and his family. Let us enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Please stand if you are able and to sing our hymn of praise. This is the day found on page 801 in your hymnals.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. You sound very good this morning. Very good. Let us now bow for a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come into this house and gather to praise and worship you, let us clear our minds of all distractions. Let us clear our hearts of anything that comes in the way of worshiping you. As we find ourselves in the middle of winter, let us enjoy this beautiful day that you have made, and let us reflect on all we have to be thankful for. Each and every one of us has received personal blessings. We are thankful for this church. We are thankful for the opportunity to be among fellow believers and share our faith with you and praise you. We know that there are needs among your congregation. We know that there are people in need of feeling your love. We know that there are people in need of feeling your grace. We ask that you show mercy on the people in need and in despair. We ask you to be with our government in this time of political separation. Be with this church as it ministers to the needs of this community and this congregation. As we go forward, let us go with excitement and anticipation, knowing that you are in control and we are your people. We ask these things in the name of Jesus' name, the one who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
The children come forward for our story time. Come on, son. Gotta gather all of our friends together, right? Yes. Okay, so I have a question for you, and I hope that y'all can give me lots and lots of good answers, because I think that y'all can do it. Mm-hmm. How do you learn in school?
The teacher teaches you.
The teacher teaches you. Avery? Okay, friends can help you.
Just raise your hand and ask a teacher.
Raise a hand and ask a teacher.
Test.
Test. Oh.
Pay attention.
Pay attention.
Listen to the teacher.
Listen to the teacher. Tyson? I'm sorry, what was that?
Maybe you can do it on your own.
Oh, maybe you can do it on your own. So what type of things does your teacher do to help you learn, Blake?
She does like groups. And
groups?
She helps you.
Okay, so groups.
Math
groups. Yeah, so do y'all do a lot of reading?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do y'all do a lot of writing?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Do y'all do a lot of cutting, pasting?
Yes.
Not that much.
I don't do pasting though.
Or gluing?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I've pasted on the computer.
Oh, awesome. Yes, pasting on the computer. Let's see, do y'all do, I don't know, a little thing on the computer or iPad to turn in?
Yeah.
You do math? So y'all do lots of different things to learn, right? I hear lots and lots of different things. So good. Y'all gave me lots of good answers. So Pastor Nate put this on the bulletin, and it says, how to study the Bible. What do you think that means? Tyson? Studying the Bible? Okay. Leland? Maybe learning the Bible?
Reading the Bible?
Reading the Bible?
Learning the words.
Learning the words. Going to church.
Understanding.
Oh, y'all are going very, very deep. How about some practical ways? Kind of model it like you were at school. If you were at school and you had the Bible, what some things would you do? Blake?
You could like read it.
Okay, you can read it. Leland? Oh, that's right. You can ask a teacher. With the Bible, yep. Any other suggestions?
You can read the words.
Yes, you can read the words. Y'all don't have as near as many answers as you do for school. What is it, Tyson?
Maybe
you can color it. I think that's a possibility.
Because it is.
Yeah, it is. Because you can draw pictures. Yeah, so you can read the Bible, you can ask your teacher. Did you know what? You can, what would this be?
Search for the Bible.
Search for the Bible. Yeah, you can use that wonderful thing called the internet, right?
And it's called Google.
It's called Google.
Google Classroom.
Yes, indeed. You can use Google to look up things in the Bible. Did you know that there's a lot of people that wrote a lot of things about the Bible?
No.
Oh, yes, lots.
The Bible every night.
No, it's not just, this is not the Bible I'm talking about. I'm talking about, you know, different authors like Barbara Brown Taylor or C.S. Lewis
or John 10:9.
Well, yes, or John 10:9, our memory verse, that is correct. Oh, yes, absolutely. There are lots of different ways that we can study the Bible. There's also lots of different ways in which to hear it. So as kids, what can you do to study the Bible?
We could ask someone to read it for us.
You can ask someone to read it to you. Yes, that is one way. Very good. Do y'all have group discussions in school?
Yep.
No. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Sometimes.
Rarely.
Yeah, it's not all the time, but do you? You know what? You can have a group discussion about the Bible.
And you can talk about what it may mean to you. And that's okay. But we are going to talk about that. Of course, coming to Sunday school is helpful, right? Yeah. Because how do y'all learn in Faith Forest? What are the six ways that we tell the Bible story?
What did you guys do today?
What did y'all do this morning?
Cooking.
Cooking.
Art.
Art.
Music.
Music.
Play games.
Eating. Playing games.
Yeah.
We get into storytelling.
True.
So we there's one more, and I'm trying to think of what it is off the top. Science. Yes, absolutely. Those are six different ways to study the Bible, and we do that with one story. Correct? And are you able to learn something new each time?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. So studying the Bible is very important. It helps you to learn and to grow. It helps you understand what it is Jesus wants you to do. And Pastor Nate's going to be preaching about this for the next few weeks, so we'll be hearing that. So how about we hold hands for prayer time with one another, if you can. All right, here we go. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you so much for the Bible. And we thank you there are so many different ways to help us study it. May you help us learn and to grow. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. All right, so all the ones going to children's church, line up over there by the door.
I want your finger.
The rest of you go back to your parents.
Yeah, please have your
fingers. No.
Good morning. Please stand and join us as we sing Good, Good Father.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night. You tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, because you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Good, good,
perfect
Father.
In all of your ways. Oops, sorry.
Sorry.
Chorusing in, sorry.
Yes.
You're a good, good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. You are perfect in all of your
You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love, love, love. You're good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am, your good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
You may be seated.
As our ushers make their way forward to receive this morning's offering, join me in a time of prayer. God, as we sing a song just like we got done singing, it makes us realize that you are a good, good Father, and that your love is something that we can't describe. We join here in this place to worship you. A God who loves us, who cares for us, who would send Jesus to die on a cross to rise again on the third day so that we can have victory over death and life everlasting. And God, sometimes when we wake up in the morning, we wonder if we're even blessed, if you're even there, if you're even a part of our lives. And just being able to know Jesus, being able to wake up this morning, being able to be a part of this church family here at First Baptist makes us realize just how blessed we are. Forgive us of those times that we forget to come back and say thank you for all that you do for us. And as we take this offering this morning, we pray that every penny would be used for your honor and for your glory so that this church can continue its long legacy of sharing and showing the love of Jesus, not only here in Topeka, but all around the world. We thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Please stand again and join us as we sing Because He Lives. I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of His blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because He lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends because He lives. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone away. Amen, amen. I'm alive because He lives. Amen, amen. Let my song join the one that never ends because He lives. I can face tomorrow because He lives. Every fear is gone. I know He holds my life, my future in His hands. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because He lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because He lives. Amen, amen. Let my song join the one that never ends because He lives. Because He lives.
Amen. You may be seated.
God is good, and all the time, God is good. Wow. We are going to begin a new sermon series this morning. We just finished up 5 weeks of talking about misquotes in the scriptures or things that we thought were in the Bible but really weren't in there. And that really leads up to this sermon series, which is titled, How Do We Study the Bible? I think a lot of us get tripped up. I'll be honest, I think sometimes with words we don't understand, theological concepts that are difficult to comprehend, and so on and so forth. And it's the same way with sharing our faith. We believe that if we share our faith with somebody, they're going to ask a really difficult question. We're not going to know the answer to that question. We're going to get embarrassed. We're going to shut down because we just don't quite know how to deal with that. And so this four-part series is all about a real practical way that you and I can look at Scripture, apply it to our lives, and be able to tell other people about it. Because to be very frank and to be very honest with you this morning, the Bible is really of no good unless we are able to apply it to our everyday lives. Amen? It really is just another history book unless it speaks to us and speaks to our generation today. So I'm really excited about being able to preach through this. We're going to talk about the SOAP method. So today we're going to talk about Scripture. Next week is observation, application, and prayer. And I hope through that we'll be able to have a better understanding of how do we study the Bible for all of its worth. So I want to start by asking a question. I just want you to think to yourselves on this. If you think about what you know in terms of Scripture, maybe Bible stories such as Noah and the Ark or Adam and Eve, Jonah and the whale, the Ten Commandments, the life and story of Jesus or other theological concepts, maybe even the birth of Christ, the Easter story, those sorts of things. Where did you learn those things from? I want you to think just for a minute. Where did you learn most of what you know about those particular stories and situations in Scripture? Because I think most of us in this room, including myself, we've got a lot of our Bible knowledge from a pastor or a Sunday school teacher or even from our parents. Would most of you agree? Yeah. So how do we know that these people are right? How do you know that when I get up to preach a message and I open up the Bible and I talk about what those scriptures mean, how do you know if I'm right or if I'm wrong? How do you know if your Sunday school teacher or a pastor before me, or maybe even your parents who taught you scriptural truths, how do you know if those folks are right or if they're wrong? See, I think one thing that we have to understand is when pastors preach or Sunday school teachers teach or our families try very hard to instruct us in the ways of the Lord, they have to do that with the Holy Spirit's leaning. I've seen too many pastors, too many churches, too many Sunday school teachers just sort of take the Bible or take what a Sunday school curriculum says or take what somebody else has taught them, and they have just sort of gone with it. And I think that's what happens a lot of times when we learn from a pastor, from a Sunday school teacher, or somebody else, we just sort of go with it. I pulled this out of my office this morning, and back when I was in middle school and high school, I used to jot down notes from the pastor's sermon. So, for instance, this was on September the 5th at Central Baptist Church in Winfield, Kansas. And the message title, and Pastor John was preaching, it was Dangerous Areas. And so one of the things that I highlighted after I wrote all of these different notes down from his sermon was, we have the biggest friend that we can have, which is found in Jesus Christ. I think that's pretty easy for us to understand and accept, right? That Jesus is our friend, that God loves us. But there's a lot of other things in here. And how do we test and know if what people tell us or what we hear on TV or if what we hear on the radio, how do we know if those things are scriptural or not? The very first Sunday after I had candidated, the very first Sunday that I started here, I made sure to say that I want each of us to understand that there's something that I want from you. And one of those things that I wanted from the congregation is to always test what I preach. There may be things where we don't always agree, and that's okay because that's what makes us Christian, and we interpret the Scriptures sometimes a little bit differently, and that dialogue is good. But there are certainly essentials and non-essentials in Scripture. So I wanted everyone to know how much Scripture means to me and how much I take in high regard the study of Scripture. So beyond a pastor or beyond a Sunday school teacher or parents, where do you think people find Bible knowledge? I want some audience reaction to this. Where do people go? Friends? Okay, what else? Google? Somebody else? Okay. Any others? Holy Spirit? Say that again. Bible stories? Okay, one back here from the choir. Bible study groups, yep. Say what? Alexa? Yeah, if you have a smart home, you can always ask Alexa. Google never lies, right? So Melissa sort of already kind of gave this away, Pastor Melissa, but I want you to look at the front of your bulletin again, and this is sort of the sermon series graphic that we're going to be using for the next 4 weeks, but this is a picture of a search engine for the internet. And so, you know, a kid said it very wisely and said, well, Google it. And it was always a joke when I worked for Region staff because they would talk about things way long ago. And I'd go, well, let me Google it. And so when you go to Google and you type in how to study the Bible, it brings up 99,200,000 results. Yeah. So when people want answers to today's questions, if they're computer savvy at all, they usually go and they'll Google it. Now, as Pastor Melissa alluded, some of these articles and websites are absolutely great for studying and understanding Scripture, and some of them are just junk. And so how do you cipher between all of that? Most people will just go automatically to the one that's on the 10 first most searched results, and they'll click on those, and they take whatever they read as gospel, so to speak. So this is what this message series is all about. It's a series for us to be able to have a common sense way to study and understand the Scriptures. So if you have a copy of the Bible, whether that's in front of you or on a phone or tablet or somewhere else, I want you to pick that up this morning. We're going to be in Romans chapter 15, and we're going to start in verse 4. In Romans chapter 15, verse 4, it says, "For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the Scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we may have" what? If you're already there. Hope. That we may have hope. So how in the world did we get the Bible to begin with? We see this collection of books. How did we even get that? But first, I want to talk about a couple of misconceptions. One misconception is that the Bible was written down, copied, and distributed all at the same time. And this is what I can guarantee you. The early church, right after the death and resurrection of Jesus, did not have a way to print off copies of Scripture, okay? And distribute them to the Church of Rome and Church of Corinth and Ephesus and Philippi. It didn't happen that way. And no, they didn't email it at that time either. So no, the Bible was not all written down and copied and distributed all at once. And the other misconception is that there are many Bibles, so how do we know which one is the right one? If you watch the History Channel for any length of time, you'll see things like the Gospel of Thomas and other hidden Gospels that have been found. And there was sort of this litmus test that was used early on to understand which Bibles or which books were going to be put into the Bible and which ones were not. Many of the writings that we see that are coming up, to be very honest with you, after Jesus rose again and some of these gospel writers started to write some of these things down, it was huge popularity. And so you had all of these other folks that decided it was going to be a really great thing for them to write other scriptural truths. And we found out that those weren't always necessarily true. And many of these writings contradict the books that are already in Scripture, where the authorship is known for sure. So how did we get the Bible? This collection of stories in the Bible is referred to as the canon of Scripture. So whether you have this on your phone or in print, this is called the canon. This is what's put together. How did this happen? See, the complete canon in the Old Testament was put together after the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. So the Old Testament was sort of already intact, and especially the law, the first five books, the Torah, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, those books were already thought of as canonized Scripture. And then in AD 70, you have the Old Testament, which was put together as a canon of Scripture as well. But the process of recognizing the New Testament books was a little bit different, and it came later on in the Christian church. The New Testament canon was completed first on AD 70, but the 27 authoritative books that we have in the New Testament was completed in AD 397. So AD 397 is where you got the 27 books of the New Testament that are considered to be authoritative. These early councils, in which they call them, are the ones that sort of headed up on whether or not they felt like a New Testament book should be or should not be in the Bible or the canonized Scriptures. They used four different things to sort of litmus test this, and I want you to look on the screen as you kind of understand how this was done. And of course, this was done through lots of prayer, lots of Holy Spirit searching, but they first looked at authorship. The author must be an apostle or someone who is closely aligned with an apostle. And an apostle is no more than a follower of Jesus in the early church. So the first thing that they looked for was authorship. If it passed that test, then it went to acceptance. And whether or not this gospel or this book or this letter to the church was widely accepted at the time by the body of Christ. Because many times there were only just a couple of copies around. There wasn't a Xerox machine to make tons of different copies of these things. So the third is consistency. The book had to contain consistency of doctrine and orthodox teaching. Now, if it passed all three of those tests, the final one was the fourth, which is values. The book had to reflect evidence that a high moral and spiritual value would bear evidence of the Holy Spirit as its author. And so if a gospel or a letter to the church at the time could do all four of these things, then it was considered to be a book that could be put into the canon. These writings in which we have are written down by human beings, but are led, guided, and directed by God Himself through the Holy Spirit. So they're authoritative writings. They're writings that each and every one of us should be reading and studying so that it can lead, guide, and direct us in our everyday lives. These writings that we find in Scripture are inspired by God, and they belong in the Bible. So that's why the Apostle Paul, in the second letter to Timothy, with all of these different things that are being written about Jesus, gives a final charge in the third chapter of 2 Timothy by saying, And how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation in Jesus Christ. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So when all of these different thoughts and ideals and everything else were being thrown at the early church, the Apostle Paul wrote to his mentee, Timothy, and said, this is what you have to remember, that Scripture is God-breathed and that it's useful for every aspect in life. And so Timothy was a pastor of the church of Ephesus, and the Apostle Paul is also saying in this letter that the Scriptures are meant for our everyday lives, for the guidance of our church and everything that we do. Let's look at verse 5 in Romans chapter 15. It says, may the God who gives endurance, remember that word, and encouragement, remember that word as well, give you the same attitude of mind towards each other that Jesus Christ had. So there are some personal benefits to reading Scripture, because I often ask the question when I'm asked certain things, what is in it for me? So the question I want you to think to yourself is, what is in it for you? If you read Scripture this week, you read a passage out of the Bible every day, what's in it for you? The first thing that this is telling us at the end of verse 4 is that it will provide hope. Do you ever wonder what people turn to or where they go when they go through some of life's most challenging situations? Maybe there's bills that you can't pay at the end of the month. Maybe there's a job situation or a family problem. Maybe a passing of a loved one that you care very much about. Where do people go? Well, we may call our friends. We may call our family. We may do this or we may do that. And finally, at the end of all of that, when none of that makes us feel comfortable, we sort of come back to God and God, here I am. Help me. And in this whisper, God's sort of going, I've been here all along, right? And really, before we turn to our friends and our families and our coworkers and other things, we need to make sure we turn to God, because the Scriptures provide us with hope. Not only during those times of valley-type situations that are struggles within our lives, but also mountaintop experiences. Now, if you look in verse 5 and also verse 6, let's go ahead and read it. So that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Scriptures also say that we are able to have endurance through the reading of Scripture. What I love about this and what I often imagine is reading the Bible and coming to church and doing those things in which God tells us to do is often like driving in a vehicle. If you ever ask my wife a question about driving in the vehicle, this is what she's going to say. Nate lets the line go all the way past E until it won't go any further, and he's running on fumes, and then he finally stops to go to the gas station. Is that right? That is right. I am that kind of person. I just want to challenge myself to see how far I can get. Okay? I do. I love it. One of these days I'm going to run out of gas. Thank goodness for AAA. All right. But Scripture and church and the things that God asks us to do are much like a refueling station. Eventually, our cars and us, we need to be refueled. We need to be re-energized. We need to be rejuvenated. We need to have that endurance to run the race of faith that God tells us to run. So when we stop and we come to church, or we stop and we read Scripture, or we read a devotion and we study God's Word, it refuels us to continue to go on through all of life's many different challenges. The Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 9:24 through 26, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run as someone who is running aimlessly." So we as Christians, we run the race of faith. And just as an athlete competes and trains and practices, we do the same thing. But we do it by coming to church and sharing our faith with others and doing things in service and reading Scripture and doing all of those many things that God asks us to do. The other thing is encouragement. This personally comes from us being able to have encouragement with the Scriptures for everyday life, so that in all of life situations, we can bring glory to Jesus Christ. Look at verse 5 again. "Endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind towards each other, just as Christ Jesus had." It makes us wake up and say, "Thank you, God." It makes us be able to recognize the blessings that God gives to us each and every day of our lives. It makes us see life from a different and good perspective. Let's continue to read on in verse 7. "Accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the Jews on behalf of God's truth, so that the promises made to the patriarchs may be confirmed, and moreover, that the Gentiles might glorify God for His mercy. It is written, 'Therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles. I will sing the praises of your name.' Again it says, 'Rejoice, you Gentiles, with His people.' And again, 'Praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Let all the peoples extol Him.' And again Isaiah says, 'The root of Jesse will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations. In Him the Gentiles will have hope.'" So the Scriptures here in Romans chapter 15, the Apostle Paul, as he writes to the churches in Rome, he's not just talking about personal benefits, what's in it for you, but he's also talking about outward benefits. The outward benefit that we are able to have the same attitude of Jesus Christ, that we're able to understand Jesus on a much more deeper level as we study Scriptures. And as we study the Bible, our lives become a model of Jesus that other people look to. Sometimes the only Bible that people will see or will read are the ones that you live within your lives. So how are you living out the Scriptures in your own life, so that when you're at Walmart, or when you're at church, or when you're at your job or your neighborhood, you are showing people the true living Word of God? How are we doing that? Verse 6 teaches us that we can glorify God by reading His Scriptures. That when we gave our lives to Jesus Christ, if you're in here today and you say, "I have given my life to Jesus," what you have essentially done is you have said, "The course that I am going on, my personal benefit that I want, I no longer care about that. What I care about in this life and in this walk is following after God and doing what God wants me to do and living this life in such a way that is pleasing and uplifting and glorifying to God." That's what we have said. But the only way we know how to do that is to open up the Scriptures and to be able to study that. If you have ever dreamed of a life that is more abundant, more fruitful, more enjoyable, there is no better life than living a life that is found in the Scriptures. Verse 7 talks about this accepting one another piece. And see, this is where sometimes scriptural interpretation gets very dangerous. If I would give a passage of scripture to each one of you, and we would talk about it as a large group, we are going to interpret that scripture just a little bit differently. You are at a different spot in your life, and so are you, and so are you. And so you're going to look at that scripture, and you're going to gain something that I may not gain out of looking at that particular passage. If you've studied the Bible for any length of time, you know that a passage that you read a year ago speaks to you a little bit differently today, just because you're at a different spot within your spiritual walk. That's all Holy Spirit-type power, to be able to teach and instruct in ways that we need within our own lives. But I say this, that we as a church, even though the scriptures say that the outward benefit of this is to glorify God, have the same attitude of Jesus, and accept one another, it's difficult when we interpret the scriptures just a little bit differently to do that. So there are essentials in scripture. And then there are these places where we just sort of discuss and maybe part ways and know that we may not agree on this particular passage, but that we are here for a mission and a purpose that is much bigger, better, and grander than anything of one individual can do. And this is exactly what it means to be American Baptist. First Baptist Church is an American Baptist church. We are one of 206 churches in Kansas, Oklahoma, and Arkansas, and one of 5,000 plus churches in the United States. And each and every church is a bit differently. From the beginning roots of American Baptist, they joined together to do things that they couldn't do individually. And we do that as a church, right? Even though we may differ on scriptural interpretation, or we may differ on this or on that, we come together because we know we are better together than we are separate. Amen? So it's okay. It's okay to differ. It's okay to discuss. I want to end with verse 13. And it says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope." There's that word again, hope. By the power of what? The Holy Spirit. See, hope doesn't come from your own power or your own will or your own benefit. The hope that we have in this life and in this world comes from the Holy Spirit. So the apostle uses this word again, and also in verse 4, so that we can put our faith into practice and have hope in Jesus. See, studying the scriptures is a lifelong adventure. You're going to trip and stumble on things that you don't understand. And as long as I have studied the Bible and as many seminary classes as I have sat in, I still do the very same thing. Because scripture contains both very practical and simple insights, but it also is very complex and complicated. And there are just some things about scripture that we're not going to understand until we get to heaven. And I even think at that point we're not going to care, right? Everything's been fulfilled anyway. So we need to keep in mind that the overarching point of studying the scripture is to know God so that God may be glorified in our life and in the life of the church. Because the more that you read the Bible, the more that you fall in love with the author. You hear that? The more you read the Bible, the more you fall in love with its author. And I can't think of a better reason to read Scripture and to understand it than to fall more in love with Jesus. So along the way, we'll be edified, challenged, and changed forever. Are you ready to embark on a journey, First Baptist? Are you ready to understand the Scriptures in a deeper way? Are you ready to be changed forever, to have a life more abundant? Today is the beginning day that we can open up God's Word and have fresh insights into everyday life. Let's stand and let's pray. God, not on our power or our will or our understanding, but on You and Your Spirit's help with understanding, comprehending, and understanding and grasping Scripture is where we lean and where we want to go. We want to experience a life that is more abundant, life that is more enjoyable. We want to fall in love with you each and every day. And we know that we do that by studying your word. And even though it's complicated, Lord, help us through it. We first need to have a personal relationship with Jesus. So I ask, Lord, that if anyone here today does not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, that they would make a decision that would change their lives for the better forever. Also pray, Lord, that your Spirit would speak to us in a special way just about our own journey, our own spiritual walk with you. Help us to understand that there are things that we do right and there are always ways that we can improve. Help us this week to get into your word so that we know which way we can improve, to know that your Scripture speaks to us in special ways, even if we don't always understand it. We love you, and we thank you for giving us writings that we can learn from and understand, knowing that those Scriptures come directly from you. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray these things. Amen. As we continue to ask God to open up our eyes, we're going to sing, "Open Our Eyes That I May See," which is found on page 557. You may be seated. I'll ask that our servers come forward this morning. We are very grateful for them and their participation as we join together at the Lord's table. Here at this church, we join together at the Lord's table because of our relationship with Jesus Christ. When the Scriptures were written and when Jesus had gathered with his disciples, he gathered with his best friends shortly before his death on the cross, sat down with them at dinner, and talked about a bread and talked about a cup. And today, when we join together at the Lord's table, we remember Jesus' broken body and his shed blood for us on the cross so that we can have the promise of victory over death and life everlasting. So the Scriptures say, "For I have received from the Lord what I also passed on to you." The Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, he first took the bread. Let's pray. As we come to this table, We ask, Lord, that you would just help us. Help us to remember. Help us to know the sacrifice that you made for each and every one of us. And help us not to just remember today, but to share the good news wherever we go. So as we hold this cracker and we hold this cup as a representation of your body and your shed blood, may it be a powerful message to each and every one of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Jesus said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup represents the new covenant, represents my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Whenever you partake of it, remember me."
Thank you.
We are blessed to be under the covenant where the blood of Jesus Christ was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. The blood of Christ shed for you. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to partake of this bread and cup and remember how you sacrificed your life so we may be forgiven. Please stand as we do our hymn of benediction, standing on the promises, hymn number 306, verse 1.